website. It was a website that people would go to. They had to log in, and then they were trafficking and stolen identity credit cards.
Counsel, I'm going to ask you to address the other main, what I think is the other main issue, which is the number of victims. And there was more evidence in Mr. Kimes' trial than there was in your defendant regarding the number of victims. And one specific question that I had was, there's testimony that refers to some trial exhibits, but I could not find the trial exhibits in our, I could not find the trial exhibits. What were they, and did they describe a list of individual victims, or what were those exhibits?
Your Honor, I believe that the government was referring to, you're referring to Mr. Kimes' trial transcripts. Those are not part of the record in my particular case, and so that's why we didn't reference them.
Well, maybe, I guess, here's my problem. Speaking only for myself, it seems to me when there's a conspiracy trial involving a number of defendants that there doesn't have to be repeated testimony, the exact same testimony about the same topic. So I'm not concerned that it's in his case, but what I am concerned about is whether that either the exhibits or something else specified the exact victims that they were talking about.
Your Honor, I cannot answer that question. I do not know if the trial transcripts specify the number of victims.
But let me just make sure I understand it. There's four big victims, correct?
There are the credit card companies.
The companies. And then, of course, there would be the vendor victims. And is it true that we don't know how many vendor victims there are, or even if there might be multiple incidents involving a single vendor, so that there would still be a single victim?
That's true, Your Honor, yes. I don't believe the government ever actually calculated the total number of individuals who may have been affected by the...
Or individual companies, the vendors, or others.
No. My understanding is that they only... It was based on the four credit card companies or banks.
And I guess that my further understanding is that, and maybe the government can correct this if it's wrong, but is that not every merchant or vendor would necessarily be a victim because they might not have suffered a loss, some might and some might not have not.
That's my understanding as well.
Okay.
So the record is unclear both as to the amount of the actual loss and the number of victims. Is that correct?
That's our position, yes, Your Honor.
Wait, on the loss, your argument was not as to the amount, but to the foreseeability in terms of...
Yes, sir. Our argument is essentially that the district court failed to specify the amount of loss that was foreseeable to Mr. Harrison. And as we set forth, this is sort of a different case because I guess you could argue that this is similar to sort of a Craigslist website or something of that nature. It's different, for example, from the Treadwell case where these were people that were actually working together, had a joint purpose, were sharing profits. In this case, Mr. Harrison simply logged into the website, and as set forth in the PSR, he exchanged somebody's information one time. He bought a fake driver's license from a government informant.
Let me be sure I understand your argument on the loss amount. As I understood the trial, you did not quarrel with the $44 million amount. You said instead that it just wasn't all foreseeable as to your client. Only $20 million was foreseeable. Is that what you argued to the district court?
Yes, Your Honor. Mr. Harrison pled guilty without a plea agreement. We did not go to trial.
Okay. So it's not the $44 million is inaccurate. You're just saying, in your view, it wasn't foreseeable as to your client.
Correct.
Did you want to save some rebuttal time?
I will, Your Honor. Thank you.
For the United States, the district court in this case followed all required sentencing procedure and imposed a
first question will be right where we left off with your colleague, and that is, if you look at the pre-sentence report and the number of victims, there's four identified. Is there anything in the record that would support the 250 victims?
No, Your Honor, there's not, other than the district court had the benefit of, there was a trial in the Camas case, which is the case, the next case before the court, and the court heard testimony in that case that there were other merchants or certain merchants that were, there were chargebacks to those merchants where the credit card companies did not necessarily absorb.
Well, even in that case, is there documentation as to the exact number?
I don't believe so, Your Honor, but in this case, there was no, the defendant, the government's position is the defendant waived objection to this particular enhancement.
Well, don't we review it for plain error? It's an enormous enhancement for 250 victims, and if the government proved records show only four, that seems like pretty plain error. I again would say I'm not so concerned that it came in another related case, but really that what is in the Camas case, and we can talk about it again in the Camas case, but there's reference to trial exhibits. The testimony does not specify a number. It describes the process that you were just talking about. Do the trial exhibits, which we don't have, list specific victims?
Your Honor, I'm not the trial attorney. I'm familiar with the record. I searched for that, and I can search again after today's proceeding. I don't believe that there's any specific anything in the record that specifically identifies the other than the four victims and the $50 million loss.
So if that's the case, yes, there are some other victims by virtue of common sense, but we don't have any identification of those, and we don't know whether and how many of these transactions were overlapping transactions. What's the government's justification, leaving aside plain error review or waiver, to support the 250 number?
Your Honor, there is nothing specifically in the record, as Your Honor referenced, but the first defense the government would offer would be waiver. Here it was utterly unchallenged. The defendant said we're...
But then we would be looking at it on plain error.
Yes, Your Honor, that's correct. And under plain error, the defendant has to show, even if there was error that would have made a difference, a material difference in the outcome, that he was prejudiced by this error. And
here's the problem that I have. I'm sorry.
Well, let me just finish. I just want to know why, given the substantial enhancement, that wouldn't substantially affect his rights.
Your Honor, I think the enhancement, I believe it was a two-level, if I'm not mistaken, with respect to the number of victims. The main enhancement was with the loss amount, the $44 million loss.
It was a six-level increase.
I see, correct, Your Honor.
And we took it from a 32 to a 38, and the difference, and perhaps the reason why the discussion of the enhancements was foreshortened is that the guideline range was above the statutory maximum the way it was calculated. But if there are only four victims, the range is below the statutory maximum. So it strikes me that there's no way this would be not affecting substantial rights to have that correct calculation.
With the correct calculation, I think, at least with respect to the victims, it would be 168 to 210.
And here, Your Honor, the court, the district court, the PSR recommended a downward variance to 87 months, I believe, and the district court waived that off and imposed 115 months. So
did so on the assumption that the guideline range was well above the statutory maximum and involved 250 victims. So I just have a hard time with your argument.
Yes. Here's where the waiver argument comes into play. If the court had an opportunity to consider it, perhaps that evidence could have been
Molina-Martinez when the Supreme Court says that the sentencing guidelines are the framework for the sentence and the anchor that the district court must use or apply the discretion. If the framework is wrong, that is, if the calculation of the sentencing guideline range is wrong, doesn't that skew all of the rest of the determination of the sentence?
If it is shown to be wrong, but there was no, it's not been shown necessarily, Your Honor, to have been wrong in this case. The court didn't have any obligation to delve into it under the Christensen case because there was no objection made to the enhancement.
But the district court must make a determination as to the appropriate sentencing guidelines as a first step. And if there was no evidence whatsoever to support the number of victims for that six-level enhancement, isn't that an error?
If there was no evidence, it's just that the evidence was not necessarily adduced because the court had no occasion in this matter to probe that, where there was not only a waiver, but the defendant agreed, unambiguously agreed that the calculations were correct. So there's no showing necessarily that it was incorrect. There was not evidence adduced because there was no occasion to have done so, given the defendant's agreement that the calculation and the enhancement applied. And otherwise, the court applied a reasonable sentence where this was a drastic downward departure, well below the statutory maximum. Unless there are any additional questions, I have a little bit of time left, but I've submitted, unless there are any additional questions.
I don't believe that we have any additional questions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Durham. You have some rebuttal time.
Unless your honors have any additional questions for me, I would submit it as well.
I actually do. Is it your position that the defendant not arguing about the six-level enhancement is the same as agreeing it's accurate?
No, Your Honor. In fact, some of the cases that the government cited in their